So this is the paper that I've been working on with colleagues at in the Research and Impact Assessment Division of IFAD. So we are looking at migration, demography, and agri-food systems. And this is the result of a workshop from CJIAR. And the ambition is to produce a book that looks at the future of agri-food systems. So what can we expect? What are the emerging trends in agri-food systems, and how do they interact with other emerging trends around the world? So it's a global perspective to this topic. So the context of this paper is that we are thinking of the rural transformation process being shaped by evolving and changing agri-food systems. So on the one hand, we see that rural employment is still agri-food systems still employ a large share of people in developing countries, which is not just the employment in farming, but also non-farm jobs related to agriculture production. And this leads to an increasing connection between rural and urban areas and the rural and urban sectors of the agriculture industry. And there's a lot of documentation for some success stories, especially in some Asian countries. And for other countries where these trends are only now starting to emerge, it is still to be seen whether they can document the same success in the transformation process, or what will be these emerging trends. So we are trying to give some insights or suggestions of what could be the emerging trends. And at the same time, these transformations are happening in a time where the demographic structures are also changing around the world. So the rural population is expected to still be growing in some regions of the world, and especially for the African region, there's the talk about the youth bulge, which draws a lot of attention to it with the discussion of, okay, what is happening with all these young people, especially in rural areas. And we also now want to add the question of, okay, what is the role in this with rural to urban migration, and also the migration of especially this age group of youth. So just to give you an insight in what do we mean by agri-food systems, as we are here more coming from the migration research area. So agri-food system is the economic system that includes farming, food and fiber manufacturing, and the trade of the goods produced in this process. And they are embedded in a changing economic system, the globalization system, technological change, urbanization that leads to also dietary change. So the idea of a changing agri-food system the change of dietary demand leads to change in more processed food being demanded, especially by urban population. And then if you think of a domestic market of agri-food, of food production, that means that now the farmers do not directly sell their raw produced food to the consumer, but actually there are many more intermediaries that then not only trade the food but also process it further and creating value added, which then of course also adds to the context of the globalizing world, where we have the question of, okay, do you rely on your domestically produced food and develop a manufacturing sector domestically, or do you rely more on imported food? And these kind of all these factors play into the changing agri-food systems. And what is important to keep in mind is that in developing countries, they provide around 80% of the jobs, due to the majority of employment still being in the farming and non-farming sector. And the other important aspect is that they are bringing the rural and urban sector closer and closer together. And I will talk about this a little bit more in a second. So what we try to do in this chapter is to, on the one hand, outline conceptually the interactions between demographic changes, rural-urban migration, and agri-food systems. And then we use population data to try to project emerging trends in rural-urban migration, and also in relation to changing in the rural transformation process. We're also discussing a little bit the role of climate change in all these changes, and identify research and data gaps. for further research and investment needs, and the focus of the paper lies in developing countries. So we only look at developed data from developed countries to have a kind of comparison for this. So the outline of the presentation to follow is that I present briefly what the conceptual framework underlying our analysis, then the data we use and the methodology to create these rural urban migration projections, and I show you some graphs of the resulting projections and discuss briefly the role of climate change and conclude if time allows. And so the conceptual framework we are in is that traditionally, the idea of rural urban migration is very much focused around the dichotomy of rural and urban areas and having push factors in the rural areas and the pull factors in the urban areas, that then with additional like development of more models also included factors such as land constraints or insurance constraints, and in the urban sectors, the possibilities of earning higher wages, to diversify your income sources, and so on. So what we are seeing now as emerging trends is that this dichotomy is actually diffusing. So we still have, of course, push factors in the rural areas, that now, which are more and more discussed, also relate to unemployment, especially of youth, natural disasters, climate change affecting the agriculture production process. And in the urban areas, as pull factors, we also can identify more the better infrastructure and connectivity, improved information. So mobile phone subscription is up through the roof. Also in developing countries, so the costs of moving to the urban area and the information costs are much lower than they used to be, so that migration to and from rural areas is actually becoming easier, this would suggest. Additionally, we have the emergence of mid-sized cities. We have the emergence of mid-sized cities, it's not to say that they didn't exist before. This is also about the attention of researchers to this topic, that now recently we have seen there's more and more attention towards mid-sized cities and towns, what role they play compared to just thinking of a rural hinterland and a metropolitan city. We actually have these centers in between that are important especially in the agri-food value chain. And this implies that these previous rural-urban dichotomy between food production in the rural area and consumption in the urban area is also shifting, kind of radiating more and more together, and the value chains move connecting rural and urban areas much more. And this also implies for rural-urban migration that we think less about this one directional movement, but acknowledge much more that there's more circular migration, rural-rural migration, seasonal, temporary migration happening between these areas. So for giving you some trends in rural population, youth population, and rural-urban migration, we use the population data from the United Nations. So on the one hand, we have rural-urban population by age for the past 35 years, and we have population projections for the total population, but also for just the rural population. We have projections of population by age group, and we have data on the life expectancy, which we use for some adjustments to account for different fertility stages that countries are in. And we also have data on agricultural productivity that we will use to look a little bit of how migration, rural-urban migration trends relate to rural transformation. So the country groupings, I will show you the graphs in, focus now on the regional country groupings. We do the same thing also by income group, but I will now focus on the regions. So we have East and Central Africa, West and Southern Africa, Northern Africa, Middle East, Central Asia, Asia and the Pacific, and the LAC. And the other countries, I will not show you any results now, but we had some data for them as well. So this is just to give you an idea of what are the population projections of the UN for these different regions, for rural areas. So in the rural population is expected to continue to increase in the African regions, and it appears to have reached a peak already in the Asia and Pacific and Latin American Caribbean regions. So there it's expected to decline. These regions are more and more urbanized. And in MENA and Central Asia, it appears that it's still increasing, but will reach a peak around 2040 and then slowly also decline. So this is to keep in the back of your mind. And the youth population similarly is expected to still to grow in Eastern Southern Africa, Western Central Africa, but it is expected to reach a peak around 2020 in the Asian and Latin American regions. And whereas in MENA and Central Asia, it's also expected to increase and eventually towards the end of the projection, possibly reaching a peak. So there is definitely this well-documented expectation of having a larger youth share in the African regions. So now we want to look at what do we think, based on this data, what happens to rural urban migration rates and rural urban youth migration rates. And this methodology is a survival ratio method. It is actually, you can think of it as a kind of population accounting exercise, let's say. So you think of a closed country, so you have a total population, you have the rural areas and you have the urban areas, and you have the total population data and project it up to 2050. And then you are thinking, okay, you can compute how many people, what is the rate at which people survive in 5 year steps. So the population in 2005 minus the population in 2000 relative to the population in the base year 2000. At which rate do people survive to the next 5 year period? And then you say, okay, we know that in urban areas people live longer, and in rural areas the mortality rates are higher. Therefore, the survival rate in rural areas is expected to be lower. So we use this assumption to compute for rural areas, starting with the rural population that we have observed in the data up to 2015, and we can then compute with this survival rate how many people we expect to live in rural areas in 2020, and then compare it to the projected rural population of the UN data, and if this projected if the population, the rural population that we observe and that we predicted with the survival rate are different, then these people must have moved somewhere. And based on our assumptions, they must have moved to the urban area. So, of course, this is based on the strong assumptions that there's no international migration directly from rural areas. So it is assuming people move from rural areas to urban areas, and then they can move further to international destinations. And this rate that we compute also does not account or is not able to differentiate between rural urban migration and urban reclassification. So when a rural area is classified 5 years later as urban area because population size in this area was growing, so the administrators decided this should now be classified as urban. So what the projections that we will show you, you can on the one hand, you can see as rural urban migration rates as well as urbanization rates in these regions. So if you believe our assumption, you can say this is all migration rate. If you're more skeptical, then you can think, okay, a lot of this will reflect that actually these regions are urbanizing more. And for youth migrants, we do the same procedure, only that we have to account for the difference in fertility transition stages, because you saw that the youth population is expected to still increase in some regions, whereas in other regions it's expected to decline. So we adjust for that in order to do the projections for this. So the rural urban migration trends that we get from our analysis is that Overall, across the world, it is expected to decline and kind of be fairly stable around 5% rate. Whereas in the East and Southern African regions, rural urban migration is expected to increase. In the Western and Central African region, it is fairly stable. And whereas in the other regions, you can see the kind of decline and flattening of the migration rate. But what is important to note here is that Eastern and Southern African regions start at a very at a much lower migration rate. So all these regions seem to somehow converge, if we can say so, at a migration rate of around 5%. And if we look at this for the youth migration, we can see that in West and Central Africa, where the overall migration rate was expected to stay fairly stable, youth migration rate is actually expected to increase. And the same so for East and Southern Africa. Whereas in the other regions, it is again either declining or in the Asia and Pacific, it is slightly increasing and then flattening. So we really see a specific trend for the African regions. So when we now try to connect this to the change in the agri-food system, and there one of the big challenges so far for us was that we could not find a good indicator or like a lot of data to document in a global comparison, a global picture, what's going on with these trends. So we tried to first look at the evidence for changing agri-food systems in specific countries, and there is some evidence that proximity to cities is associated with higher agriculture production from a study in Ethiopia. And there's another like a equilibrium model exercise looking at investments in rural areas compared to urban areas and how that affects the agriculture GDP growth. And they found that for a country that is like for the country Uganda, where agro-processing sector is actually very large, the investment or larger urbanization, larger rural urban migration is related to faster agriculture GDP growth. So there you see exactly these kind of predictions of a rural transformation process in this study. And then there's another, there's other strand of studies that looks at what can be expected, what the employment potential of this agri-foods sector is to employ the rural population. And it says that the farming share of employment is expected to decline, and the agri-food system non-farming sector is rapidly growing and expected to continue to rapidly grow. However, the actual share of employment of the sector is still very low. So they predicted, I think it was up to 2030, a share of 12% in the non-farming employment. So it's still a relatively small share, even though it has a potential of being rapidly growing. So it's kind of a, there is a potential there, but it's not not that large that it could give the opportunities for everyone as alternative to farming. And then we looked at the rural transformation process. So we define countries that had an average annual growth rate of agricultural productivity above their regional average for the period from 1990 to 2014 as fast rural transformers. And in contrast, those that were growing slower than the regional average, they were slow transformers. And based on this category, we plot the migration rate for the period from 1985 to 2050. And we see a very clear pattern of kind of the rural transformation process seems to be going hand in hand with a fast increasing rural urban migration rate, which is expected kind of happen for those countries that had been slowly transforming. I quickly skip this. So climate change, we also reviewed, as a short summary, we reviewed the evidence that exists on impacts of climate change on migration, but it is still very thin and not too clear. So one thing that we did find is that there's some evidence that increase in temperature would increase international as well as rural urban migration, especially when countries are highly agriculture dependent. And we also reflected on the role of medium-sized cities that on the one hand are expected to be more vulnerable to extreme events because they have not as good as an infrastructure as bigger cities, but at the same time they offer the potential to reduce the vulnerability and to increase the resilience for farmers by offering more opportunities. So we definitely say there is a big gap still for more evidence to be produced. And maybe as one of the main messages so far is that we, from the projections, we want to definitely stress the point that rural urban migration is not a phenomenon that is expected to disappear. And we see some sort of pattern of convergence. And it also seems to be a process accompanying the process of rural transformation, which has to be shaped by policymakers. And we also emphasize the gap in research and evidence for seasonal migration. Then, of course, we acknowledge our gap in the research of addressing the reclassification of rural to urban areas, and want to investigate more the impacts of climate change on youth migration. Thank you.